Today I'm going shopping, which you know I hate to do. Oh my gosh. But I had to pick my worms before going. This is the red wigglers that are like exploding in here. There are so many cocoons and they are just getting huge. Later when I come back, I'm going to dig in there and show you again. And let's see how these little guys are doing over here. I just put them here for a few days just to keep an eye on them. Everything is good in there. All right, off to the stores. So here are the red wigglers that I've kept on this table in this bin. You guys have seen me experimenting with them. Yesterday I gave them the worm chow, and today is the next day, 11 a.m., and the worm chow is gone. So as you can see, if you look up close, there are little cocoons everywhere. I started this bin with just a little handful of worms that I saved from the bin that went anaerobic. And I already had some cocoons in here, but they have multiplied like crazy. I mean, look at them. So these are red wigglers, Yersinia fetidas, or Yersinia fetida, however people call them. There are no blues in here. And guys, it took me a very long time to get to this point of having no blue worms in here. And blue worms are not a bad worm. I just wanted pure reds. I don't know, out of curiosity, my preference. I've had worms that have had blues in them and I've had to like pick them out. Especially when I go online and I order red wigglers and I get 100% blues sent to me. I'm not crazy about that. I mean, if you're gonna have blues mixed in, just put it on your website, tell people. You know, most people are buying these worms for composting. They're just not going to care. But it's just better to be honest. I mean, come on. Better to be honest. So they're doing good. It's time to harvest them and get these cocoons out of here and divide the worms. So I'm going to leave it uncovered. Just going to let it air dry a little bit while I do other things around here. And then we're going to get them out of here. All right, guys. So here I have some coconut coir. I have like a bunch of bricks lying around, so I might as well use them. The easiest way to break this up is with warm water. It just is. I have found it to break up easier. Now I'm soaking it in mosquito dunk water to help control the little flying insects, fungus gnats or fruit flies or, you know, whatever. I have to take precautions like that because, I mean, I have a lot of worms in here. And because this is all natural, no chemicals, no, you know, it can happen. So, see, look. See how easy it just breaks up? Warm water is the trick. So I'm going to have a lot of this. These two bins, this is probably going to fill a few of these. But, you know, I figured let me just get them going here. I let them soak for a while I do other things. And as you can see, it soaks up the water really fast. So I'm going to have to put more water in here. And I do it slowly until I see that it's not soaking up any more water and my peat moss is damp. This stuff is great. It really is. And if you have it, you know, lying around or you have a lot of it, just use it up. I've used it with the worms for years. I've used peat moss. I usually use both. I use whatever I can get. Sometimes it's about finding what you can or what's on sale. Because let me tell you guys, it's not cheap doing all this. But I love it anyway. So I'm going to keep adding water. pour some more water in here. And you're thinking, wow, that's a lot of water. Believe it or not, it will soak it up. And if it doesn't, and I have water like sitting, my solution, shredded paper. That'll help soak up the rest. And this stuff soaks up the water a lot faster than peat moss also. See? If I were to leave this and come back in an hour, this will probably be gone. So how are you all doing? Getting ready for autumn? Well, autumn is here, but the cold here in Indiana hasn't hit yet. But at night, we're starting to see those temperatures go down, so it's going to start soon. Oh, look, this one broke in half. Oh, wow. Look. I'm trying not to use my other hand because that's when I use it to touch my phone. I'm watching Donnie Laws up there. He has a video on ghost stories. And, you know, it's that time of year. It's spooky season for me, which is my favorite. Halloween's my favorite time, so I watch a lot of haunted things and scary things and paranormal things. I wanted to go do the, they have this thing here where you go shoot killer clowns in the forest with paintballs, and they're not doing it this year. I don't think they could get people to work it, so no killer clown this year for me. See, look how fibrous this is. Yeah, the water's pretty much gone in this one. And this one, yeah, look, it's there's still water, but it's slowly vanishing. Okay, so in each bin I put 2 or 3 inches deep. That's it. You really don't need more than that. And this has a lot. So this stuff is going to be divided by the 4 bins. And I might even have some left over. I mean, who knows? This stuff starts drinking water. It like disappears. Yeah. So do you all dress up for Halloween? I'm going to dress up for work. They're doing some kind of contest. It's gonna be fun. I love doing things like that. Let me keep spreading this out. So I added my dolomite lime, my azomite minerals. Even though this is not peat moss is very acidic, I still like to add a little. It doesn't hurt, just good to have. So now, I gotta get the worms. All right, so I harvested one of those trays. Took me, I don't know, 10 minutes. This is the one that had the worms in it, the top tray. See? And this is the one that has the castings that didn't fall through in the cocoons. This is the one that the top tray I use 1/4 measurement in the mesh. And this one is 1/8. So this is loaded with cocoons. And I'm sure there are baby worms in here. Like, look here, I found one. Like that little guy. So now I take this and I put it in the nursery to grow out for a while. Or I can set it up on one of these bins and leave it there for weeks and wait for them to hatch. I've done both. Both do okay. Depends on the amount of room I have. So now I'm gonna let these guys go down. I'm gonna make a little mountain over here. Oh my gosh, look at this. So if I want the worms really fast, I'll wait for them to go down and I'll do that trick that I usually do, which is if you don't see them here, you go like this and you flip it over and you just start grabbing them and there they are. But I'm just gonna let them go down and I'm gonna use two brushes to get the castings off of them. I use this bigger one and I also use a smaller one. Just depends what I have around. I usually have both, but sometimes I'll put a chair up and I'll do this and I'll listen to your videos in the back or I'll listen to an audiobook. This part is actually, I find it very therapeutic. I don't know. It gives me a chance to spend time with them and just see how they're doing, their bedding is and their behavior, you know. Just gives me time to look in on them better because I spend time with them. Don't think that worm farming is an easy career. It is not. It's a lot of hard work and dedication. It is very messy. It just is. As much as I clean, as much as I do, that's just how it is. And I think it's worth it though. Look at this little baby. Where's the camera? How cute. I'm gonna put him in with the cocoons. So I'm gonna get that going. Let me show you another trick I do. So as I'm going like this, let me push one. Every once in a while, I'll get a worm that's bigger. So what I take him, I take the bigger ones and I throw them here in the corner. That way they all start congregating over there and there's less here for me to brush off. I mean, that's not a big deal, but I don't know. I just discovered that a few years ago and it really has just made it easier. And I see a lot of cocoons here that the mesh did not catch. It's not going to catch everything. Sometimes the cocoons are a little smaller, especially these red wigglers. So they're always going to be cocoons around, guys. I mean, that just is. So every once in a while I see one and there it goes. So let me keep working on this. What do you think, guys? I keep going like this, the red wigglers are just going to be more exposed. So you see these little rocks, these little things? That's some of the oyster shell that I put in. Sometimes I don't grind it. I just sprinkle it in here and most of the time it dissolves, but there's always a piece or two that stick around for a little bit and that's okay. It doesn't hurt the worms or anything. So now I take this and I divide it among this one, that one, that one, that one, maybe even more. Put it on the shelf with date it so they can start growing out. This is the medium I took from on top of them. I know there are cocoons and baby worms in here. So I will mix it with this one and I have a choice. I can put it in the bins to grow out and date them and have like a separate cocoon only section, or I could dump it in the nursery in the other room. I've done both. Both works. Depends on the room you have, the time you have, what your style is, if you feel more comfortable doing it one way or the other. I mean, you just do what you like. Both ways work though, because I've done both. But these are some good looking worms, guys. They really are. So I'm going to end this video here because I'm about to get real dirty. If you like my videos, like and subscribe. Go visit my worm channel. Visit my my website, thegardenandwormlady.com. I do have African nightcrawlers on there, European nightcrawlers, and pretty soon the red wigglers are going to appear on there. I do make their worm chow myself here in the wormery. I'm making my blend now, the Garden and Worm Lady blend that's on there. It's what I personally feed all my worms. I have fed my worms eat the chow I give them. But anyway, go ahead and subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you guys next time. Take care.